Commission 11-2030 perspectives and provocation. And I have to say, I'm super scared to speak about of the future, about the presentation that we just heard. I have far much less data than the word present. But I would say that our journey today will go through ideas on four main dimensions of the future. How the world is going to look like, or at least the ones who are, let's say, thumb guessing or forecasting, that is more or less the same thing, would say that the world is going to be in 10 years from now, 11 actually, what the consumer is going to be, which are the features of the cars, which are of course a very important destination of the market for leather, how factories will look like, and then we'll go back next year to see how leather looks like in 2020, and we will try to see how it will look like in 2030. So, as it has just been said, we will have to face some problems, but there are some also good news in 10 years from now. I would say that the best good news is that the child mortality will be below 2%, at least this is what is forecasted. There will be a start of space tourism. Of course, the world, as we have already heard, is going to be overpopulated. There will be water scarcity, and therefore desalination will be a major technology and energy consuming industry as well. 6G standard is going to be released. We're going to start space tourism, but at the same time, orbital space junk is going to be a problem because of everything that we are, satellites, etc., that we are sending up already. But more importantly, for probably the people in the room, half of US malls will have closed. So that there is also a radical change in the way retail will be, and this will be one of the most evident impacts that is closer to our industry. As a consequence of that, or as a consequence also of what you have been hearing before, for example, the aging of the population, how the consumers will be featured. I just took examples of the data that are in several studies of everybody that is looking about the new generation of consumers. But consumer of 2030 will be old and active. So-called active aging is a feature that is affecting also product design, like for example in footwear. There is a clear trend toward comfort in shoes, even in classical designs. We will be urbanized. We were speaking about land use before. There will be an increase in the surface of cities. But if a consumer is urbanized, it means that he's, I call that, serviced. So that it will be available. The consumers will have a lot of services. Probably not going out of home that often. Predominantly middle class, even if the trend is called the rich getting richer, poor getting poorer, but the portion of consumers that is going to be classified as middle class is going to be growing. Focused on health and wellness, and again, this is another topic that is heavily or predominantly influencing also the leather industry. I call it empowered designer. So we are already seeing models in which the consumers are not buying objects, but in particular in interior design, they are buying drawings, 3D drawings, that then can be manufactured or 3D printed to be then delivered to the house of consumers. We say experienced shoppers, particularly e-shoppers, consumers in 10 years from now will have learned how to shop better than now. Maybe advertising will be less important than it is now. The easy use of internet and the, let's say, predominant age, plus of those that are now called millennials, which will have a bigger purchasing power in the future. It will bring us to a consumer that is an experienced shopper, informed, conscious, and selective. So that, again, probably the messages of advertising will drastically change, focusing more on brands rather than telling half lies on products. And of course, consumers will be 100% of the time connected. If we look at the car 2030, Gustavo was mentioning that we are also involved in the automotive sector. Yes, we are. We are working with high-level groups in the European Commission in several projects. And we are analyzing the trends of the industry under a different angle, because for us it's interesting to understand which are the skills that the automobile industry will require in the future. But these skills are very much linked with the product features. So that, again, I have selected some of the trends which are published in this report. For those of you who are interested, it's called Gear 2030, and it's publicly available on the internet. And these features are that the car of the future will be connected with automated driving technologies, will be mostly or at a larger portion electrified. If the research on alternatives to lithium batteries gets to a proper direction, there will be larger proportions of the car's components, including interiors, that will be 3D printed. They will be using new and advanced materials in which weight is a key feature. Why weight is a key feature? Why weight is a key feature for you? What is there any idea? Yeah? Because they will need to be efficient and will increase their range with the same amount of energy. So the automotive industry of the future will face the same problem that the aircraft industry, the aerospace. The airlines are facing now. And if we go back to leather as a material, of course lightweight leather is preferred in aircrafts, but on cars it's not a problem yet. We have been speaking about carbon footprint or environmental footprint, and I think that if we speak about, well, it's not just anything, I am speaking and I'm in touch with OEMs, sustainability managers, that are, of course, telling me that for them, zero-emission vehicles is a key. And if you want to sell also a zero-emission vehicle, you need not zero, but close to zero-emission materials. So this is another problem why the importance of environmental footprinting will be increasing also in the car industry in the future. And then connected. And V2X means vehicle to whatever else. So V2X to connectivity is another topic that will be of great interest in the future. And of course, last but not least, mobility as a service. So actually, I've not been studying it here in the US, but in Europe, the model of car sharing is growing and growing and growing in importance. And it will be growing also in the future, particularly if you consider the increasing number of people that will be urbanized, as we were saying before. So in Europe, we see this as a service that started as a public service. So maybe municipalities were like putting cars in the streets. But now we have Audi, we have BMW, and we have other OEMs and car manufacturers that are starting their own fleet leasing services, let's say. So, okay, we'll be speaking about everything but leather. The last part is how the factory of the future will look like, and here the source is another organization we work with. It's called Factories of the Future. It's a public-private partnership with the biggest manufacturers in Europe. And just to take a reference and to make some provocations, which is my role today. So what are the factories of the future? The factories of the future will be digitalized and self-learning. So we hear a lot about industry for the fourth industrial revolution that will be on digitalization. digitalization. So in 10 years from now, the digitalization process will have ended. Not only that, the data that will be produced by digitalized machines will start to be used also through AI to optimize processes. So this is why we speak about digitalized and self-learning factories. They will be connected, worldwide connected, in a collaborative manner. There are already examples of co-designs of products, or in particular of complex process, products. The supply chains will be more and more transparent. I don't know, there was a speaker before speaking about Google. Google trying to measure the footprint of the fashion industry. Well, Google is also active in finding solutions to using through blockchain for traceability of materials, in particular for fashion. It's a very recent news. Factories of the future will be sustainable and urban. Sustainable, the meaning is obvious, less resource consuming, with a clear direction of reusing materials, minimizing the use of resources. Urban, this is a little bit more curious, but we already have examples of the so-called factories close to consumer or factories in shops, which is a very fascinating concept in my opinion, because it's also the empowering technology for customization in our industry, which is another very curious and very tempting subjects to go through. And this means that the production will need to move towards just in time, no stock, less immobilization of running capital, money, and more efficient processes through just in time technologies. This one is a concept that I kind of invented the day before yesterday. It's bio-organical, so from chemical to bio-organical. It's a trend, a clear trend of evolution also in the production of reagents and chemistry that are used in different factories that are starting to use biosynthesis and biofabrication to produce molecules that are then used in different. Cobotical means that robots will. A cobot is a collaborative robot. Okay? So it's a robot that interacts with humans. And we see, if any of you have the pleasure and the luck to go into the new R&D labs of big brands such as Gucci, for example, you see that the production also of leather goods in Italy is moving towards cobots, where humans are interacting with robots, increasing efficiency and standardizing the production. So, okay, I've tried to be, like looking at the future now, let's go back to Earth, and it's, among all these features, of course, everything that we said until now has an influence or has an impact on the features of materials. And we have to speak about what is leather now and what is leather going to be in the future. Well, leather is resistant and long-lasting, and this is a feature that is influencing a lot of the topics we've been discussing before. By the way, this is a picture of the microstructure of leather. For the many of you, including myself, a few days ago, who didn't know, leather is circular. We've been saying about it I don't know how many times today, but let's make this concept very clear. It's the valorization of a byproduct of the meat industry, and therefore I was very scared to see the graph in which the slaughtering, I'm wondering where the slaughtering gets to zero, because if that is going to be a problem for the leather industry. It is resource efficient. We have been already speaking about the amount, the reductions in the use of chemistry resources and energy that have been achieved. And you know why? Does any of you know why the leather industry is like so well performing in sustainability? In the past, long, long, long time ago, tanneries were outside the walls in the medieval age in Europe. Tanneries were outside the walls of the cities because they were stinking. They were using dirty materials. And that has created a misconception and a very important factor that is the environmental pressure, the pressure on tanneries on environmental improvement. And this has created a the effect that the tanneries are the ones who started before other industries to go towards sustainability and sustainable models. Why? Because they had a lot of pressure from the public opinion from the very early stage. Just in time, we have examples. I don't know about examples in Italy, but we have examples, so in US, but in Italy, we do have examples of companies who are investing in huge finished project stocks so that an order can be delivered in one day. There is no more need for 5 days lead time, 5 weeks lead time, or tanneries are so well organized that they bring the semi-finished product down to the last moment in which the lead time is 1 week. So we can say that customization of products will need just-in-time materials that are a reality today. Well, authentical, we were discussing about the different features, and I think Mike also has I was discussing in Boston last week with a student of Wentworth Institute and said, oh, I like authentical leather, meaning that leather still has that perception of being a material that has an authenticity. It is transparent. This is an example of a simplified model of a supply chain of a simple production for leather goods, in which you see how many different actors are involved, in which there are traders of live animals, in which there are different farms, in which these different farms are selling to different slaughterhouses, then to different traders, and so on and so forth. So it is a very complex supply chain, but the industry is moving very much and very hard towards full transparency, going back to the farm. It is surprisingly light. If we measure the strength of the material compared with the thickness, that leather is commonly already used in the aerospace, let's say, industry. It's easy to clean, as it has been said before, and it's sustainable. Does this look like a tannery? It is a tannery in Italy, built 2 years ago. Is it a nice factory in your opinion, or is it ugly? I think it looks good. But it's still analogic. So we are working to improve on that. The amount of possibilities of improvement using artificial intelligence for process improvement is incredible, because it's a stable substrate that uses chemistry and water to transform collagen. So this is a kind of problem that the genius and the nerds like very much to optimize through AI, something that we didn't get there yet with human intelligence. And then leather 2030. I can tell you that there are several topics in which we are going. Okay. And to understand, I invite you to come to Milano next October, October 2nd to October 4th. But I can give you some ideas. Basically, this year we will be speaking about six major topics. Fit for you, meaning customization. Nanotech trends. We have called on wearables. We have called that we are able, no? Because basically wearable are enabling products to provide functions. And the whole section of biogeneration, biofabrication, upcycling, and design for upcycling in particular, which is a topic that is of very high interest for myself. And then possibilities of providing new aesthetic properties to the material. And these are just very short examples of what you will be able to see. On the loop view, we have LED embedded in leather and other materials as objects that are starting to communicate